going to have to just go with the slightly weaker PowerPoint. I'm sorry, I can't get it to work proper, but I do have this working. So, okay, starting over at the beginning. Deep cleansing breath. So this Jew's on his way to America, and it's the 1890s, and there's a lot of restrictions on how much wealth you can bring into the country or take out of the country. I'm not exactly sure if the joke makes sense, but at any rate, he's a dentist, and so he converts all of his liquid assets into gold teeth. You know this one already.
I told it.
You told me, I'm sorry, I forgot. Someone else told it to me, so
well,
the joke goes like this. It was funnier when someone else told me, I'm sorry. So what happened was, he gets 5 sets of gold teeth. He gets to Ellis Island, and you know, he's declaring his property, and he says, I don't have very much in terms of liquid assets, but I do have these 5 sets of gold teeth. And the immigration officer says to him, 5 sets of gold teeth? Why do you need 5 sets of gold teeth? He says, well, you see, I'm a very observant Jew, and I this isn't really strictly speaking necessary, but I like to have 1 set for meat and 1 set for dairy. And the immigration officer says, oh, that's very good. Okay, so that explains 2 sets. What are the other 3 for? He says, well, you know, we have this holiday, Passover. We're very strict about what we consume. And so I have 1 set for Passover meat and 1 set for Passover dairy. He says, okay, that makes a lot of sense. You must be a very religious, pious man. That explains 4 sets. What's the 5th set for? He says, well, the truth is, every now and then I like to eat a little bit of Chinese food. All right, sorry, Joe. Is that the punchline you used?
I used the ham sandwich.
Ham sandwich, okay, all right. We're in shul, I don't want to talk about the ham sandwich. Okay, so today's discussion tonight is about Stephen Samuel Wise, a very important figure in American Jewry, and in many ways, as we shall see, he was really a formative figure in defining what was an American rabbi. He was of the Reform movement, Reform persuasion, and so we're looking at him primarily in a historical vein. Obviously, here we are standing in an Orthodox synagogue. There's a lot of issues we may have with his religious orientation and his approach to Torah, but this is a history course, and we're using his biography to kind of look at some of the major events that happened in America during the dates of his activity. He was born in 1874, died in 1949, and so his life really went through the first half of the 20th century, in which he was, without too much of an argument, perhaps the most influential American Jew alive. Very, very strong impact on the sensibility of what a rabbi should be for the wider American society. And I don't have a microphone on.
Look at that. Okay, that joke was so good. Do we have a sound test, or we're okay with this?
Yeah.
That's it. We are definitely canceling Mara if it doesn't give us enough time to set up. Okay. The kind of things that he stood for, he was, as I mentioned, a very prominent Reform rabbi, and he advanced the ideas of Reform in a certain direction that we will discuss. In many ways, swimming against the tide of his movement, going in a totally opposite direction. He was a very important American Zionist, representing America in the World Zionist Congress, and in fact, he had a hand in drafting the crucial 1917 Balfour Declaration, in which the government of England proposed the idea of a state for the Jews in the region known as Palestine. He came under significant controversy, which I hope we will discuss towards the end of our hour together, during the period of the Holocaust, when his style of leadership came under fire because he was normally quite a firebrand and really very aggressive in pursuing causes that fit with his larger social agenda. And for reasons that perhaps we'll explore, if not evaluate, he soft-pedaled many of the crucial questions surrounding the American response to the Holocaust, and as a result, even to this day, the end of his life came under significant criticism, and his legacy is muted as a result. Yes, Joe. He was primarily practicing in New York City, as we shall see right now. So let's understand a little bit about his background. He was actually born in Hungary, and he immigrated to America as an infant. He took his parents with him. He came from a long line of Orthodox rabbis. Most significantly, his grandfather, Joseph Hirschweiss, was of the variety that we could call Haredi. That term had not yet been coined, but we would say ultra-Orthodox, and I will explain to you, God willing, in the next slide, a little bit of a sense of what that means in terms of the development of Jewish denominationalism in the 19th and early 20th century. His father, Aaron, was also of that persuasion, ultra-Orthodox, but immigrating to America with his son, he slowly moved a little bit to the center of the spectrum and is actually one of the founding members of the Jewish Theological Seminary, which is the premier institution of the conservative movement. And in fact, during those early years, was very close to, in many ways, philosophically, Yeshiva University. In fact, at one point, they actually discussed a potential merger. It never came about, but it gives you some sense of how close the movements were at that time, at the beginning of the 20th century. The son, you know, if we say the father was Haredi, and the son moved conservative, the grandson became Reform, and in fact, a very powerful Reform rabbi. He, among other things, was the founder of the Jewish Institute of Religion, which later emerged with the Hebrew Union College, which is the premier institution training Reform rabbis to this day. The term neologue, by the way, that's the Hungarian equivalent of what the Germans called the liberal movement, or what we in America call the Reform movement. It is a movement that believes that Judaism is malleable and that it should ideally adapt to modernity in such a way that practices which may be enshrined in an Orthodox way of thinking as being sacrosanct may be changed, modified, and so on to meet the social economic needs of the Jews of their time. Let me put this on a... Oh, this is such a drag. It's too bad the computer is not functioning right, because I had all this great animation set up. Like last week, I was playing with it, so you'll just have to... I'll have to use my little red thing here to explain what's going on. So the denominational spectrum, I'll walk you through it. You have to imagine there are these great effects where the arrows drop in and there's exploding noises and things like that. The Jewish denominational spectrum is something that emerges in the 19th century. It especially is very profound, and the contrasts are sharp in Germany, which if you'll recall the lecture we had a few months ago on Moses Mendelssohn, that's really the birthplace of Jewish denominationalism. What do I mean by denominationalism? You know, Jews have for centuries, as long as there have been Jews, there have been disagreements among Jews as to how to worship God properly. But there have always been, up until really the 19th century, there have always been basically a kind of an understanding of what's in the box and what is outside the box. What is considered, you know, legitimate areas of dispute where family members can argue about what the right thing to do is, and areas where if you do something like this, you're outside of the family, or to use the Hebrew idiom, chutz lamachane. The kind of movements that were chutz lamachane, outside the camp, include the Karaites, for example, who denied the validity of the oral Torah, things like that. And there are scattered movements like this, the Sabbateans, for example, scattered movements like this throughout time. But for the most part, the bulk of Jewry kind of followed in one broad path. While there were ethnic differences between Sephardim, Ashkenazim, and so on, and that could be translated into actual practical differences in terms of what you eat on Passover and so on, the broad area of Jewish practice was common to all Jews. This changed dramatically in the 19th century, really in the beginning of the 19th century, when there was a grassroots movement in Germany of disaffected Jews who felt that traditional, what we would call later Orthodox Judaism, did not speak to their spiritual needs. It also did not meet their ambitions for social acceptance among the non-Jews, especially in Germany. And so, In a rather rapid fashion, many halachot, many aspects of Jewish law were abandoned overnight in a kind of a slavish imitation in many cases to try and ape non-Jewish sensibilities. There were actually two separate votes held to try and move Shabbos, for example, to Sunday, because it would be much more convenient to have Shabbos on the same day as non-Jews do. Those motions were defeated. But other things like importing an organ into the congregation to be played on the Saturday, things like that were major wholesale changes. Whoa, what's going on here?
It'll kick back in.
It will? No, but I have to put my password in. Oh. the computer is just not working the way we want it to.
What's your password again?
Yeah, it's 7 small dots. There we go. Okay, and will it kick in now? Yeah, it's searching. So am I. Searching. Okay, so what you'll have to imagine here is there's a line that goes left to right that is... Okay, there we go. See, your imaginations are very powerful. A line going left to right, which on the right wing you have insularity. So you have Jews who believe in greater insularity, greater separation from the outside world. The outside world is dangerous, toxic, and so on, and so we want to keep into our own culture, it being self-sufficient for everything that a person could want. On the other hand, on the left wing, you have openness, which is this notion that, no, there's a lot that we can gain from the outside world, and we should be willing to adapt ourselves to that outside world and so on. And Jews fell along this spectrum. In terms of movements, the so-called Haredi movement, which we would call ultra-Orthodox today, this is not a term that was used back then. These are modern terms used backwards, anachronistically, to describe these. These were Jews, particularly in northern Hungary, very strong population there, also in parts of Eastern Europe, who said, no, modernity must be rejected. We must do everything as traditionally as possible, the way it was done in ancient Israel, the way it was done in, you know, medieval France. We have to keep to the same traditions, and we have to view the outside world with mistrust. On the other side here, you have the neologues, which is the term in Hungary for the reform, who said, no, we should be open. We should, you know, attend universities. We should appreciate the opera. We should dress like non-Jews, learn the vernacular language, and so on. Rather than feeling like we have to, like, you know, circle the wagons and stay within our own culture, we should explore the outside world and be active participants in the outside world. Later on, here, these actually moved. It was really cool in the animation. You have to use your brackets. You have the so-called neo-Orthodox here, who were Jews who said, wait a minute, change is inevitable. We have to deal with it. We have to adapt to very radical social changes with emancipation, but that does not mean that we should sacrifice the Torah. So the Neo-Orthodox, also known as the Modern Orthodox, believed in examining Judaism carefully and culling those practices which are not actually halakha, not actually Jewish law, but are customs that have accreted to Judaism over centuries, issues of, you know, styles of dress and things like that, that can be jettisoned without too much difficulty while keeping the essential halachot of Shabbat, Kashrut, Taharat HaMishpacha, and so on. And those were very prominent here in Germany. And since they are more towards the openness end of the spectrum, I've moved them to the left of the Haredim. And then over here on the left side, you have the conservative movement, then in Germany called the historical positivist movement, not very big in Hungary at the time, but they believed in similar values to the Neo-Orthodox, but a little bit further to the left, more towards openness than towards insularity. There is, however, this bright red line, this is driving me crazy.
Yeah.
This bright red line, and I'm logged out again. Joe, I don't know if we should let you in. It's too hard to deal with you here like this. But there's a bright red line, a line in the sand, however, that separates these movements. The Neo or Modern Orthodox and the Haredim to the right, ultimately, they believe that in the immutability of Torah. There are 613 commandments, Torah from Sinai, and it can't be changed. They may argue, like, do you have to wear this kind of hat or that kind of hat? But they say, hey, you've got to wear, let's say, a head covering. That's not necessarily a good example to take because that's not one of the 613 commandments, but never. Let's say, you know, they will disagree, let's say, on what you can read on Shabbat. Can you read a secular newspaper on Shabbat? But everybody agrees you have to observe Shabbat with the traditional 39 malachot. Whereas on the left-hand side of the spectrum, there is this idea that, you know, perhaps not all of those 613 commandments were actually given by God and are mandatory. And that certain elements may have, you know, come into Judaism over time. They don't necessarily fit. So when we look at the spectrum today, we're now moving to the left end of our spectrum for our discussion, looking at the reform movement, which is much more in the openness spectrum, but willing to sacrifice some of the things on the red line over here. Joe, I'm scared to call on you, but okay.
This is a legitimate
question. Okay.
How do they differ from the Tzedukim?
Oh, major differences, because the Tzedukim, the old Sadducees, accepted the validity of the written Torah.
Only,
right? They didn't accept the oral Torah, at least in theory. But over here, there are a lot of commandments which may not be accepted, even by the Reform movement, saying, well, why do we have to stick with the written Torah? But it's in the same idea. Oh, yeah, it's in the same kind of idea in many ways. Very good. Let's go on. So he immigrated to the USA. It's kind of an interesting story how he got here. His father had a very strong kind of social welfare slant to his thinking, something which his father which his son certainly inherited. And he criticized the way his father-in-law, that is Stephen Samuel Wise's maternal father, he criticized the way he ran his porcelain company. And in fact, he started to unionize his father-in-law's company, get the workers organized in his father-in-law's plant. So the father-in-law turned around and bought him and his family one-way tickets to New York City and got rid of the union maker by shipping him off to New York. And that's how he came, our subject, came to New York as an infant. Just looking at, you know, more broadly speaking again, the history of immigration of Jews to America, I'm not going to spend much time on this because we want to concentrate on other things, but we have basically three very significant waves of Jews to this country, increasing in numbers by the time we get to the middle of the 20th century. The first Jewish immigrants to these shores were Sephardic immigrants. In the 17th century already, Jews who had been wandering from country to country after the Spanish expulsion of 1492 and the Portuguese of 1497. Some of them went down to South America and then made their way up to North America, where they settled in various locales. We even have some locations here in Florida of these early Sephardic settlers. They were just a trickle, though, tiny numbers. In the 1840s, we begin to get a much larger wave of immigrants from Germany, Jewish immigrants from Germany, who are primarily fleeing for economic reasons and the oppressive nature of the anti-Semitic legislation in the German and Austro-Hungarian empires. There were, for example, as we discussed also in the Mendelssohn lecture, there were restrictions on marriage for Jews. Jewish grooms had to possess a certain amount of hard cash in order to get a permit to marry. And second and third sons in a family had to produce even larger amounts of cash. It was a very crude form of Jewish birth control, which today is only exercised, for example, through day school tuition and, you know, mechanisms like that. That's a joke. They're probably going to take that out of the Torah Cafe version of this. But that's the idea, is that if you were a third son from a middle-class family in Germany, you had little chance of legally marrying a Jewish woman. And the only way to marry a non-Jewish woman would be to convert, which was also not an option. So you had a large number of primarily male German Jews coming to America starting in the 1840s. They got to these shores, and they actually did fairly well. By the time we get to the 1880s, they're already well-established, wealthier. They have built many synagogues in New York in particular, and this is the environment into which you have the largest wave of Jews, about 1.75 million Jews coming between 1881 and 1917. These are Jews primarily from Eastern Europe, the eastern parts of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, Russia, Congress Poland, places like that. And these Jews just overwhelm the existing Jewish communities of German Jews who have now become quite assimilated to American culture. Part of the big story of the last quarter of the 19th and the first decade or so of the 20th century is the conflict between the old German Jewish establishment, which has really set down roots and has become wealthy and has done a lot to try and improve the image of Jews by Americanizing themselves, having to deal with this wave of the so-called Ostjuden, the East Jews, who are unkempt, Yiddish-speaking tend to be much more religious in terms of their observance levels than the German Jews, and the German Jews kind of like, in somewhat of a patronizing way, care for their needs, but at the same time are really asking them to Americanize very quickly because you're an embarrassment. And there's a conflict between these German Jews and the Eastern Jews. Weiss, of course, came from, he just predated the major influx of Jews from Eastern Europe as a baby, but he was very early to adopt the English language and American sensibilities, and he succeeded tremendously. He had ambitions from an early age to join his father and grandfather in a much longer tradition as a rabbi. As I mentioned, however, he pursued the much more liberal approach of reform rabbis, and he was actually ordained by this man, Adolf Jelinek, very important rabbi scholar of the 19th century. And this is something that I'm hoping to emphasize throughout this lecture, is that, you know, the image of a rabbi in America changed dramatically during this period of time, and the model that was perhaps strongest, as evidenced by Weiss himself, was through his role models, which were these scholars, these rabbi doctors from Germany, who all had, you know, advanced secular degrees from universities, along with rabbinical ordination. Their observance level, their piety, their charitableness, their counseling abilities were considered less important than their sheer brain power, how many books they had published, you know, how erudite they were. It was kind of like a status symbol to have a rabbi who really, you know, could lecture at the local university as well as ministering to a congregation. There are very few of these nowadays, but this was kind of like the model, the gold standard of rabbis in the first half of the 20th century. I'm sorry? No, he was not. He was very reformed.
He was ordained.
Well, Adolf Jelinek gave him a reform ordination. So he was not an Orthodox rabbi by any means. His teacher was not an Orthodox rabbi by any means, but nevertheless a rabbi scholar. I mean, Jelinek and others, you know, published a lot of really good scholarship, mainly within something called the Wissenschaft des Judentums, which means the science of Judaism. There was this idea, very prominent in the 19th century, that Judaism was like kind of like a static culture, like studying ancient Egypt. And all, if you wanted to be a scholar, you studied this dead culture that was not moving or going anywhere, and you translated things from Hebrew and Akkadian and Ugaritic and things like that, and that's how you demonstrated your largesse and your intellectual power. You know, the idea of a rabbi as a pious figure, as a spiritually enlightened figure, was not considered high status in Europe or in America even at this time. Absent, of course, the Eastern European model, where you have the Hasidic rabbi, very charismatic, very populist, you know, may not be deeply literate even, but that's an entirely different model of leadership that was accepted by Jews at that time. Mr. Lax.
What was his PhD?
Oh, so now we're going back, not Jelinek, now we're going to Weiss. Weiss, you know, was educated here in America, and he did a PhD at a very young age. I think he was 24 or so when he finished it. Actually, that's right, we can figure 25 years old. He translated Shlomo ibn Gibriel's ethical treatise, I forget which one it was, but he translated basically a medieval Spanish manuscript from the Arabic, you know, talking about real scholars here, and that was his PhD dissertation. He also translated much of the Bible for the Jewish Publication Society, you know, and he was one of these early Hebraists here in America. Okay, he married an exceptional woman named Mary Louise Waterman in 1900 when he was about 26 years old. She was an unusual woman. She was a disciple of Felix Adler, who was a very important thinker at the beginning of the 20th century in America and a little bit earlier. He founded something called the Ethical Culture Movement, which was basically Judaism without God, in my humble opinion. A lot of like secular version of Jewish values, but palatable if you really didn't want to do all the God thing. And very profound, huge impact on a lot of secular thinkers, including Jews who lean towards the secular. She ended up becoming quite an intellectual force of her own, perhaps in a later lecture series. We'll spend more time looking at her life in particular. She was a translator, a scholar herself, translating many Jewish works, especially modern Zionist works from several languages, wrote many of her own books, and was a social activist really functioning at the highest levels of American government. She passed these values along with her husband to their rather exceptional children, shown here in their youth. The son was also quite a prolific author. This is a family that wrote a lot of books. He even wrote a biography of his mother, which is probably the best thing a Jewish boy can do. I'm going to have to write one of those of my mother. That would be, I think, really nice. And he had a tremendous skills in the art world. He ended up moving to Europe, where he was an international art connoisseur and expert on various forms of art. His daughter, their daughter went on also to become an author and to become a judge at various levels of the circuit courts. She was especially important in child welfare issues. She advised Eleanor Roosevelt and served on many high-ranking national-level committees working for the welfare of children. So really an exceptional, overachieving family all around. Now, going back to his life, they moved to Portland, Oregon, and they spent some time out there where there were not so many Jews, but nevertheless, he was beginning to make a name for himself. In 1906, he was invited to Congregation Emmanuel, perhaps the leading German Jewish establishment synagogue, to try out for a position as their rabbi. Again, a Reformed temple, and he's invited at a young age to give some trial sermons. Apparently, there's some dispute that actually went on in the press afterwards. It was a national issue, believe it or not. Apparently, he was offered the job, but he refused because the congregation refused to give him what he called a free pulpit. In other words, he wanted kind of like what the universities call tenure. He wanted to be able to say whatever he wanted from the pulpit without fear of losing his job. The board of the congregation was unwilling to grant this to him, and so he declined. And there was quite a bit of machlokas, of controversy over these version of events. He ended up going back to Portland, but then he came back a year later and established a rival temple, which actually became even more famous, the so-called Free Synagogue. And he called it the Free Synagogue because it had, of course, a free pulpit, meaning he could say whatever he wanted and not get fired. But it also had free high holiday seats. You could, everything was free. It was based on donations only, but there was no fixed price membership. Everything was designed to be totally open, very much in consonance with his social welfare values. Yes, Joe, I'm afraid.
Who was his backers?
I don't know. I imagine he had some fairly wealthy individuals. He's a very powerful speaker, very charismatic. I didn't do research into where the money came from. But it reminds me of a joke. Did you hear the one? I'm telling it in the middle. I won't catch it. The one about Goldstein comes to the door to get in on Yom Kippur, and the gabbai holds him back. So Goldstein goes to daven. He goes to the shul on Yom Kippur, and he goes to walk into the sanctuary, and the gabbai says, "Where's your ticket?" He says, "I didn't buy a seat." And he says, "I'm sorry, you can't come in." And he says, "But I have to get in. I have to talk to Goldfarb. It's crucial." He says, "Look, I'm sorry. If you don't have a ticket, you can't come in to be with the congregation." He says, "It's really important I talk to Goldfarb. It is a matter of life and death. Really, you have to let me in." So the gabbai says to him, "Okay, fine. You can go in, but don't pray." Okay. All right. I also like the iconography Stephen Samuel Wise is pretty amazing. He always has this. I didn't find any pictures of him smiling. It's always strong, stern, kind of like steely-eyed, determined, you know, fighting kind of images. Here he is with his son working on a railroad project at the time. Yes.
Did that Free Synagogue turn into the Central Synagogue?
I do not know. I'm sorry. Any New Yorkers here?
Yeah.
Oh, so. I don't know. Did the Free Synagogue become the Central Synagogue?
Yeah, because that was built around that era as well.
I'm sorry, I'm a Canadian, and I try to avoid New York City as much as possible. But I know a lot of people like it. I find it so, you know, you got to put on your New York face when you're walking on the street there, you know? And like someone, it's like, you know, you put on, you're like, don't mess with me. I don't know. It's like if you're in a building and you hear people coming to get to the elevator, you push the closed door button, you know, that kind of.
I like that.
Anyways, I don't mean to cast asparagus at New Yorkers. They're a lot of them are wonderful people.
Interesting to find out.
Yeah, I'll have to look it up. Now, also in terms of his, you know, political orientation, his philosophical orientation, he was a huge liberal, and this made a big impact on the way Jews thought in the first half of the 20th century. He was the founder of all kinds of, you know, civil liberties type movements, including being the co-founder of the NAACP, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, very important institution for African Americans. He was also a very important founding member of the American Civil Liberties Union, the ACLU, very active today. You know, forthright defenders of very unpopular causes for the purpose of upholding the values of the Constitution. Again, quite often very unpopular, but nevertheless serving a valuable purpose as kind of a watchdog of government abuses that could be otherwise exploiting people. Very big, like his father, you know, who tried to unionize his father-in-law's shop. That's a recipe for Shalom Bias disaster, if there ever was one. He was also very big in promoting labor causes, and he hunted out corruption wherever you can find it. In fact, one of his campaigns even brought down the mayor of New York, James Walker, who was found himself under so much stress of corruption charges because of Samuel Wise's activity, he ultimately resigned in 1932. On the Jewish side, he also founded the American Jewish Congress, which was a more liberal and at the same time more strident institution of American Jewry, an organization that was founded largely to distinguish itself from the earlier American Jewish Committee, which is a little bit more old school, you know, play nice and try to get along. The Congress was much more, you know, active in exposing anti-Semitism and, you know, working for social causes outside of the Jewish community as a whole. At the same time, Wise was very much a Zionist, and this put him at odds with the Reform Movement at the time. The Reform Movement had taken a position already in the 19th century opposing Zionism. You know, we might think, well, what could be wrong with Zionism? Why would a movement, you know, especially one of openness, argue that Zionism is incorrect? You have to put yourself in the mindset of 19th century Germany when the Jews are trying desperately to demonstrate that they deserve to be emancipated. And one of the charges, sometimes with an anti-Semitic basis, sometimes I think a legitimate political argument, is saying, listen, where do you belong, Jews? Do you belong here in Germany as German citizens? Or are you here as sojourners, as travelers, hoping ultimately return to Israel, perhaps under some messianic period? The specter of dual loyalty. If there ever were to be a war between, let's say, Germany and France, which happens about every 30 years in the 19th century, and you have to fight against French Jews, which side will you fight on? Or even if there were to be some kind of Jewish state, would you go and join that Jewish state, or would you remain loyal to Germany? So the Reform Movement took a very principled stand, saying no to Zionism. Our home is here in Germany. And you see that in a lot of different ways. Like, for example, the very use of the term temple to describe a house of worship, that's in Hebrew, that's a loaded term. We use the term synagogue, Beit Knesset, which means basically house of gathering, right? Beit, house, Knesset, of ingathering. Same thing in Greek, sin means together, goga, which means to congregate. But the term temple, there's only one temple in Jewish history, and that's the temple in Israel, in Jerusalem. Okay, it was destroyed and built, so there's really two temples. But to call, for example, your building Temple Emmanuel, means this is our home right here in Berlin. And so they took a principled stance opposing Zionism. Weiss, however, disagreed with that and promoted Zionism, even though it went against the opinions of classical Reform. Oh, and by the way, most Reform rabbis later came to Weiss's position as well. So the Reform movement did shift along with Weiss. But even here in Miami, I understand that, I think it was Temple Israel, for a long time they had classical Reform where there were these kinds of attitudes back in the, 50, 60 years ago. But I'm not sure. I probably shouldn't say that. Please, Elliot, please take that part out because I'm not sure about it. But I make lots of mistakes. There's a lot of things you can cut out. But at any rate, he founded the New York Federation of Zionist Societies in 1897. That's a really early date. The World Zionist Congress was founded that same year. So we're talking about quite early on in the Zionist movement. He worked hand in hand with Herzl. Herzl dies in 1904. And so the last very productive years of Herzl's life were conducted with Weiss at his side as his primary representative to the strong and growing American Jewish population. He represented American Jewry in the World Zionist Congress in Basel. That would be the year after it was founded. And as I mentioned earlier, he was also very much involved in helping draft the text that ultimately would be issued by the British government as the Balfour Declaration. Now, let's just look here a little bit about how that sort of thinking was played out by American Jewry. And I want to jump ahead a little bit to say how American Jews really were absorbing the kind of values that Weiss himself extolled. I'm not sure that he is the primary factor involved, but nevertheless we see his thinking quite prominent. And I know that this is pretty much very well known to most of you in this room, but to all the undergraduates I have who are going to be watching this on the web, who are, younger than 25, this is going to be surprising, shocking even for them. And the first thing is that the vast majority of Jews historically voted Democrat. That's something that especially Orthodox Jews would say, what? All my friends are Republican. I only know Republicans. But it's something that's a little bit of a quirk for Orthodox Jews in the last, say, since Reagan, since the 1980s. But overwhelmingly, Jews voted Democrat. If you look at this chart here, this shows the Jewish vote in presidential elections from 1916 to 2004. I have a little bit later statistics coming up. This shows all Jews fill up the chart. So up to the top is 100% of Jews. In those elections, you can see that blue is by far the largest chunk. It goes up and down a little bit over the years, depending largely on which candidates are running, but overwhelmingly, with the exception of the 1920 elections, the overwhelming number of Jews, way more than 50%, voted Democrat.
How do you know that?
Well, we have polling. I'm sorry?
How do you know they were Jews?
Well, they're either answering the polls incorrectly, the exit polls, or it's an anti-Semitic plot. It's one or the other.
But they ask you your religion when you went to exit polls.
Yeah, exit polls, sure.
That's who you voted for.
Yeah, and they ask you your religion too. Where do you live? If you don't want to answer, you don't want to answer. But this is really good research from Ira Sheskin, a very important Jewish demographer, perhaps the world's greatest Jewish demographer alive, who's actually right here in the University of Miami. His research is rock solid. And this has not been contested. The vast majority of Jews voted Democrat. However, and let's look at this, for example, I'm sorry I didn't have 2012 election results to show you, but this is a similar kind of material on the 2008 election. So if you look at how people voted by ethnicity, you can see that, and also I tried to figure out how to make these blue and red, but I couldn't figure that out, I'm sorry. So if you look at Caucasians, whites, a little over 50%, let's say about 60% voted for McCain, Republican, and closer to about 35% voted for Obama. Among Hispanics, the number is reversed, where you have many more Hispanics voting for Obama than for McCain. Obviously, Romney experienced something similar in the last election. Among blacks, this is a huge surprise. Only a tiny percent voted for McCain. And overwhelmingly, of course, they supported Obama. And look at Jews here. Jews are voting more like Hispanics than like Caucasians. This is what Norman Podhoretz once said, that Jews make money like Presbyterians, but vote like Puerto Ricans. Meaning that Presbyterians, old-style Mayflower Americans, tend to be wealthier. Wealthier people tend to vote Republican. But the Puerto Ricans, relatively new additions to the American continent politically, with less wealth per capita, they tend to vote Democrat. So Jews, overwhelmingly, let's say two-thirds and higher, tend to vote Democrat, even when they're rising in the socioeconomic scale. And of course, the total population is pretty much 50-50 in the 2008 election, pretty much the same thing in the popular vote in the 2012 election. And now let's look at how denomination makes a difference as well. This is different for Orthodox Jews. So if we break down, again, 2008, the numbers that I've seen anecdotally, I didn't look very hard, but the numbers for anecdotally for 2012 are pretty similar. If you look at Jews overall, you see that most Jews voted for Obama in 2008, but a significant minority, about 38%, maybe a little lower, voted for McCain. When you look at the Orthodox respondents, however, the numbers are reversed. About 75% of Orthodox Jews voted for McCain, and about a quarter, 25%, voted, where's my, there it is, 25% voted for Obama. So for reasons that are too complicated for us to go into today, the Orthodox vote tends to be the reverse of the general Jewish vote. General Jewish vote is higher Democrat, the Orthodox vote is higher Republican. And obviously the reasons for this is too much for us today, but I want to emphasize the idea of the liberalism that's closer to the Democratic values that is clearly the emphasis, the influence of people like Weiss. Yes, sir.
Could it be the Orthodox voted not for Obama because they thought he was a Muslim?
There can be a lot of reasons. You can look at perceptions of his support of Israel, perceptions of his quote-unquote progressive social values, whereas the Republican candidates seem to want to represent more of a traditional family issue. There are a whole host of issues that you can use to unpack this vote here.
If it wasn't for his being black, would that be any different?
That's a good one.
Yeah, well, I think the my guess is, and this is like I'm in the history department, but not in the theoretical history department, but I would guess that the numbers might not be as extreme, but when you look at candidates before Obama, before 2008, this pattern was holding as well. Yeah, Orthodox Jews since Reagan were breaking away from the Democratic trend, and the Republican trend was increasing. I think it has mainly to do with the perception of what is the social agenda. Issues like abortion, gay marriage, things like that, you know, tend to polarize Orthodox voters. And so a lot of those things fold into this. At any rate, so if we take the Orthodox out of the equation, this is all like Stephen Wise's kind of activity. Yes, Joe. Sir, go ahead, Joe, and then.
Do you have a chart like that on Kennedy's election?
I could get one.
Here.
Yeah, if we have a chart like this on Kennedy, so I don't know if I'll do it this, maybe I can squeeze it into another lecture, but the point that I want to emphasize here is Wise's influence. Please.
Hispanics are not one group. I mean, you have Jews who are Hispanic, loads of them.
Sure, that's true.
I find that a very peculiar.
These are very rough numbers. I think you get a better idea if you look, for example, there's some really good studies done at the local level in New York City. And if you look at neighborhoods, zip codes that are overwhelmingly Orthodox, then Romney is like off the charts. There's like 3% Democratic voters, and it's all Romney. And then you cross over to another zip code where it's more African American, all of a sudden Obama's off the charts. So you get a much more like a scalpel precise view when you look at neighborhoods. These are kind of broad tendencies overall. But valid point. Okay, let's go back to the early 20th century. He's big in international politics. This is a person who really stood on the world stage, and not only for Jewish causes. At the end of World War I, one of the major issues that had to be decided was, what do we do with the ruins of the three empires that previously occupied Europe? The Russian Empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and the German Empire, all of which did not exist in 1918 after the war. And so one of the biggest issues was, how do we divide up the territory? Which nationality gets a country? Which nationalities do not get countries? And at the Paris Peace Conferences, and the Versailles one here, You know, a lot of different groups had an opportunity to present their case for statehood. Weiss represented Zionism and the case for Israel there. He was also influential with President Woodrow Wilson, who established the 14 points, a system that was designed to try and create a test for who would get statehood after World War I. So this is a figure, we have a person who was a religious leader, social activist, prominent Zionist, very leftist in many of his views, and he's also active on the world stage. Yes, Mr. Lax.
We'll see more about that, spokesman for
Herzl. Definitely a spokesman for Herzl. He was a strong ally of Herzl's, absolutely. He, at the same time, he's writing lots of books. I don't have too much time, so this is just one of about seven books that he authored. Basically, his speeches, sermons, things like that, which later made it into print. There was the old Austrian spelling that was his father's. They changed it to Wise when they came here. Now, getting to the more controversial point, his life during the Holocaust. I'm going to have to go a little past 9:30 just to finish this. I hope you don't mind. We had to start late, too. You can leave in disgust if you like, precisely at 9:30. But, well, yeah, my videographer is going to go at 9:30. But I'll go quickly. Okay, so the controversy is, okay, the Holocaust obviously was an existential threat to the Jews of Europe. America at this time was undeniably the world's strongest economic power and had the largest concentration of Jews outside of Europe. And so the question is, how should American Jewish leaders have responded to the ongoing news of impending doom for the Jews of Germany? Weiss started with a very powerful beginning in the 1930s, organizing anti-German boycotts with the rise of Hitler to power in 1933, and generally took a very strident voice against the Nazi anti-Semitic regime. At the same time, however, once World War II formally broke out, and America was engaged in the war, Weiss's rhetoric changed, and there was much more of a deferential attitude towards the leadership of America in the war, particularly, by the way, I should say, after 1941, because America did not enter the war until Pearl Harbor. But once American young men were in Europe fighting for the defeat of Hitler, Weiss's approach was, you know, what more can we actually ask the Americans to do? After all, American men are dying. There are boots on the ground in Europe fighting for a cause which is exactly consonant with what we want, the end of the Holocaust. And so Weiss's approach was one of, you know, let's trust the government to do this, let us move forward with their plans, respect their military decisions, and so on. Many Jews felt this was, what happened to the old Rabbi Weiss? What happened to the strident critic who would stand up and would try Chai V'Kayam to try and get things to change? And they felt that his leadership was quite tepid. This is especially true after the issue of the Rigner telegram. So Gerhard Rigner was a consular official, I believe he was consular official, in Geneva, and he passed on this telegram that was addressed to Stephen Weiss. It went through the State Department, and the State Department actually held it back from him, did not give it to Stephen Weiss, but it did get to him anyways through a different route from the British Parliament. This telegram, which was dated in August 1942, gave real, concrete, and fairly accurate details about the Holocaust. And when I say the Holocaust in this context, I mean the clear determination of the Nazis to massacre every single Jewish civilian in Europe, including the mechanisms for this destruction and so on. Now, this was actually not totally new to America. There had been reports leaking out, but this was the first verified true claim by legitimate channels that was sent directly to the State Department, and the State Department quashed it. They didn't even let him know about it. And it, So what was Wise to do with this text once he found it? Here is the actual text of the Regner Telegram. This is the version that was sent through the World Jewish Congress, and it reads, "Have received through Foreign Office following message from Regner, Geneva, stop. Received alarming report that in Führer's headquarters plan discussed and under consideration all Jews in countries occupied or controlled Germany, number 3.5 to 4 million, should after deportation and concentration east at one blow exterminated to resolve once and for all Jewish question in Europe." All true. The numbers perhaps 3.5 to 4 million, but the actual plan was decided, we know, on January 22nd, 1942. We know the idea of deportation to the east. We know, of course, of the terrible death camps. Here's the version that actually came through the British Foreign Office, and it even indicates the use of prussic acid, which was Ciclone B, the chemical that was used to kill the Jews. So here we have, you know, the most prominent American Jewish leader getting a telegram that is 100% accurate and comes through a legitimate chain of transmission. What should he do with this? So ultimately what he did was he had a meeting with President Roosevelt. It was scheduled and held in 1943. The meeting lasted approximately 30 minutes. It began with a brief prayer. Stephen Wise presented this information, which of course Roosevelt already knew. It was well known from other sources already by this point. And the majority of the 30 minutes was taken up by Roosevelt speaking about his position on this. And that was basically it. And many Jews felt that this was insufficient, was that, you know, he should have pushed, he should have screamed, he should have organized demonstrations. There are also some very controversial plans, which are too much for us to go into today, but especially toward the end of the war, certain elements in the Nazi chaotic bureaucracy were willing to exchange Jews for materiel that they promised they would only use against the Russians, who were, of course, the allies of the Americans. But since the Germans were feeling a lot of pressure on the Eastern Front, they wanted, it was called the Jews for Trucks scheme, where some Jews, especially in Hungary, would be released in favor of accepting American war materiel that could then be used against the Russians. The Americans ultimately rejected the plan. It was kind of a crazy plan from a military background. Here you are trying to defeat an enemy, and you're giving aid to the enemy to defeat your ally, but it could have saved, potentially, you know, about 500,000 Jews in Hungary. So it's a very controversial thing. Wise's position was controversial. The critics is also controversial. And the legacy of this entire period is yet to be determined. So let me just conclude with a few comments. I'll take some questions in a minute. Ultimately, though, with a recap of Wise's life, we see that in many ways his career as a pulpit rabbi and as an American activist defined for many ways what American Jews, and I'm talking broadly about American Jews, not specifically Orthodox Jews, viewed as the ideal rabbi. Someone who was learned, erudite, leftist, activist, Zionist. These were the kinds of adjectives that were used to describe his life, and that was used to describe you know, the ideal rabbi for many. His legacy is one of tremendous influence on Jewish voting patterns, on Jewish thought. It's somewhat more mixed and controversial when it comes to the difficult period of the Holocaust, but nevertheless, Rabbi Wise's approach to the problems of the day definitely made a major impact on the way Jews think, even in the 21st century. I'm going to take some questions, but first I want to thank you very much for your attendance and dismiss you because we're already out of time. So thank you very much for attending.